My name is Chris Chambers, and I am an honors student recruiter here at the Honors College at the University of Houston. I'm also a junior history major, and I am minoring in leadership and management. My mom has been sick for most of my life, since I was about 5 years old. And so I'm living with a parent with a disease. She had polychondritis, which is a respiratory disease. And so, to just give you a context of what it is, it kind of makes your breathing ways about the size of a coffee straw when it's your trachea is like inflamed. And so she's been living with this disease since about 2001, 2002. And so as an early in my early age, I've been used to her going to the hospital two times or three times a year due to emergency situations. And at this age, I've almost become numb to it because it's just been happening so often. And so I lived in Dallas up till I was about 12 years old. And my father came to me, and he met with me in private, me and my sister, that is. And my mom was in the hospital at the time, and he told us that we're going to move to Houston where she can be taken care of by family. When they got back, my mom had a trach. So they had to do an emergency trach procedure on her, or she would have died on the table. And so seeing her in that state really just shocked me. She has a hole in her throat. And then with that, they don't really, in the commercials where they have people with trachs, it's always about smokers and how, they kind of demonize smoking and things like that. Where, well, my experience with trachs, it's more than just like that. It's something you have to manage. For example, you have to do a suction for the mucus that builds up almost like 3 or 4 times a day. And so I learned how to do that at about 14 years old. I learned how to change out a trach, which is really, you really need some skill for that because you have to remove the trach and then her airways will close for almost like 15 to 20 seconds. So you have to be very quick and then you have to apply lubrication to the trach. You can't just jam it in her. You have to be very ginger because that's her breathing ways. So, and mind you, like when she has a trach, she wasn't able to talk either. So she was basically mute. And so we had one of those talking machines, and she kind of she still had her spirit, when she would use that machine. Like, for example, if I'm like cutting some carrots wrong, she'll type something in the machine to criticize it. And my mom was still the same person. So it was just really tough to go out in public because even though she was sick. We wanted to still live a normal life like anybody else. I wanted to go to the mall. I wanted to go to see movies. I wanted to go to the grocery store and get fruit roll-ups from the fruit roll-up section. But everybody would be looking. People, she'll be in a wheelchair, and you see this person with a trach, and they have a lot of weight on them because of the medicines and stuff. And she's coughing, and people are shooing their children away, grabbing them closely, thinking that it's a contagious disease. I'll hear people whispering things about my mom. Saying like kids saying really mean things. You know how kids can say the darndest things like monster and stuff like that. And so there was a time where I was kind of ashamed, I was ashamed of like being out in public with her because like people would say so many mean things. But mostly I was really like ashamed of myself for having these thoughts, The last big incident I had was, well, there's been several. One of the big ones was during Super Bowl, the Super Bowl between I think the Ravens and the San Francisco whatever they are. The 49ers, yeah, that one. And so my dad was going to a social event that night and my mom was really ill, so I was at the house watching her. And then she's like sitting in the chair and I'm waiting. My dad walks out the door. And she just instantly says, "I can't do this," because she's when she gets sick, she her airways start closing up again, and they kind of go around the trach, and so I had to call him back, and then we got her downstairs, put her in the car. It's like I think 7 or 8 p.m. We rushed to the hospital, like going through a residential neighborhood at like 60 miles per hour. And so any kind of dog or cat or squirrel in the way could have been like paced because we were going so fast. And we were rushing, so I couldn't get her seatbelt on. So my dad makes a sharp turn into the emergency corridor door, and her head hits the window. And so it didn't break the window, thank God, but like she was pretty much out of it at that point. Not from the window, just from not being able to breathe for that long. So he rolls out the wheelchair himself, and then like we get her in there, and there's all this types of bureaucracy that you have to deal with when you go to hospitals that I've been dealing with, and we've been dealing with for our entire lives, well, my entire life. And then like I'm waiting for her, and my dad says she's gonna be fine. They have her stable. She's in ICU, and so and I just kind of like had to like step outside of my body and look at myself, because I wasn't like panicking or anything. At this time, I was about 17, and I just treated it like if this was the day, this is the day, you know. If this is the day that the last time I see my mom, this is probably gonna be it. You know, when you marry somebody, there's you in the beginning, you don't think that she's gonna get sick. You don't think she's gonna gain a lot of weight and like have a lot of problems and have to, you know. There was a she just really deteriorated from like 2001 and then to that state. And then like he was not concerned about the physical or where they were financially. He wasn't concerned about he was it's not that he wasn't concerned, he just didn't let that stop himself from loving her. You know, and I think that's the kind of love that we all search for, you know, that I don't think we're all prepared for. Like I don't think that he was probably the strongest individual throughout the entire situation, whether it was having to he was a lawyer, you know, he's supposed to be on the up and up, and then like he's the only income of the family paying for the bills, and then we have to move to our grandparents' house. That could have been a shot to a lot of, you know, what he's worked for. You know, we lost the car throughout that time. And so he was really he's been my biggest like motivation, like my biggest inspiration, that is, because he's been able to manage all these different balloons falling from the sky and still love her throughout the entire situation. So my dad,
Unconditional love.
unconditional, definitely. And I think we say it a lot, but it's when you see it, man, it's something.
My name is Robert Kremens. I teach here at the Honors College of the University of Houston. I thought I'd like to talk about 33 and a third revolutions. And I think the younger folks will understand this since vinyl is back in such a big way. That is the speed that we used to play, and I guess we still play albums at. So, like any revolution, an album, a vinyl disc goes round and round. It's why the Beatles' 1966 album Revolver is so cleverly titled. My revolution happened in 1985, because that's when, as a young fella grown up in Dublin, Ireland, I first got to listen to a wonderfully weird album by the American rock band REM, their third album, Fables of the Reconstruction. It's my favorite album by REM, my favorite band. And it's like being immersed in a sort of interesting, rich southern swamp. And this is a work of art which inspired me to take, I guess, what at the time was the trip of a lifetime, one that really changed my consciousness and opened my mind and captured my imagination. I'd been listening very intensely to REM for several years in the 1980s when I got a chance to come to America for the first time in the summer of 1988. And I've saved up a little bit of money. And then decided, you know, a lot of people were going to places like Florida for their vacation or wanted to go see California. But I really wanted to go to Athens, Georgia, because this was a place that I'd read a great deal about. It's a place that I'd listened a great deal about because this was the hometown of REM. So I bought myself a Greyhound bus ticket, and I rented very, very cheaply a room for several weeks with these graduate students. And it wasn't just that they were graduate students, they were people who knew a great deal about the things that I was very, very curious about, particularly about the people and the places that REM, and especially the lyricist Michael Stipe, were writing about. Weird outsider artists, weird, strange, marginal characters straight out of a Flannery O'Connor short story or a Faulkner novel. Some of these were imaginary and some of these were real. And I got a chance, along with one of my new friends, to take a road trip. We took a trip up into the North Georgia Hills to visit a gentleman called R.A. Miller, who was a preacher and also a part-time artist. And he had created hundreds of little windmills out of junk, pieces of timber and tin and other kinds of metal. And he had them all planted on a place called Whirligig Hill. It was very strange and very surreal and very wonderful. We did another memorable trip all the way to a place called Paradise Gardens, which was this biblical theme park created on the land owned by a very wonderful and eccentric gentleman called Howard Finster, who was a painter. He also did, one of his paintings ended up on an album cover by Talking Heads. Another one of the paintings is the cover of the REM album Reckoning. And he also, like R.A. Miller, was a preacher. He was speaking the truth and preaching the gospel and trying to bring people towards the light through his art. And we got a chance to visit with him, and he preached to me, and there were various prophecies, interesting prophecies about visions of boxcars full of blood. I remember that one. That unnerved me a little bit. But also walking around Paradise Gardens was like being not only in an REM video, but like walking around the landscape of a dream. He'd built all these structures himself, and one of them was like a three-story giant wedding cake, I remember. Another one was this hut, this very large hut, that was built out of the rusted skeletons of what looked like dozens, if not hundreds, of disused bicycles. We didn't really have this back in suburban Dublin. This was an American experience, the kind of which I could only have dreamed about when I got on that plane to New York City. There was a small outdoor festival that was being done as a kind of benefit concert for somebody who had injured themselves, a gentleman in Athens who was kind of beloved of many people in the music community. And many great local acts played. And it ended, the headliners were another group who I came to really like in the years after that when their albums were released in Europe, the Indigo Girls, a folk duo. And they sang with their friend Michael Stipe. And it was a beautiful performance. I can still remember virtually every song that was on that set list. By the time Michael Stipe and the Indigo Girls stopped playing, night had fallen, the moon was out, and Stipe pointed up to the sky and said, "There's the moon," and walked off stage. And that moonlit, dreamlike evening and those dreamlike weeks are something that have nourished me and sustained me and helped me keep faith in art and imagination and embrace the wonderful weirdness that we must have if we're to keep our culture alive and vibrant. On one of our road trips, my new friend's car broke down. to the point where it had to go into the shop and we weren't going to be able to get it back to the next day. And we managed to reach his family's house outside of Warner Robins, Georgia. And I remember walking down this rural road around midnight in Warner Robins, Georgia, pitch black, and thinking, I am so very far from home. And I think it felt as if that I had launched myself into the world a little bit. And this was my odyssey.
So my name is Khalid Sheikh, and I am a junior majoring in biochemistry, and I'm a student in the Honors College, and I'm also a part of the Bonner Leaders Program. Kind of a big part of my college career has revolved around education, and specifically inequality in education, right? So when I was a freshman, as a Bonner, I took a class called Introduction to Civic Engagement. And I took that the fall semester of my freshman year. I'm a junior now, and to this day is my favorite class. And essentially, we read a few books, and we had discussions, and we learned about just issues that our community faces. Our community meaning our local community, state, and also just national issues. And the one that really resonated with me was the income, the inequality in education, right? So the income achievement gap. And in the class, you know, we looked at some data, we looked at some graphs, we listened to some stories, and what we found was that students who did well in high school but came from low-income families were less likely to go to college than students who didn't do well in high school but came from well-off families. And I remember looking at this graph of SAT score versus parental income. And they are directly correlated. The higher a student's income, family income is, the better he or she will do on the SAT. And I just remember sitting in class and honestly being amazed by that, by just seeing so vividly what impact a parental income has on a student's educational achievement, and by students' educational achievement, then their chances in life, right? So basically what I was looking at, it was telling me that if a student is born, you know, in a low-income family, the chances of him or her getting out of that through education is very, very slim. And I suppose maybe I had a picturesque view of, I guess, the society we lived in.
What was your view?
Well, the view is that, of course, America is a land of opportunity. If you work hard, you'll be rewarded. But sometimes the data dispute that. And I guess really my journey to understanding this inequality began even before I entered college. And so I got a group of four other students together and approached a nearby high school, Cesar Chavez High School, and pretty much talked to the principal and asked, you know, hey, can we hold an SAT prep program after school for some of your students? And they liked the idea. And our mission really was to kind of to fight the trend. Now, this was back in the spring of 2015, and since then, we've served a lot of students. The program has changed, it has grown, and we've seen, I think, tremendous success in our mission of improving SAT scores. But as we, as we're working with the program, working with the students, we realize that kind of the issue is bigger. It's not just the SAT scores. It's a lot of different things. So this year we've expanded the program even further, so that it's not just the SAT we're working on, but we're also providing just scholarship help and just general college preparation that these students do not get, that their higher income peers do get. Really, if you want to really prepare a student for college and for the SAT, you have to start freshman year. Not even freshman year. You need to start in middle school. And not even in middle school. You start earlier than that. Because plenty of studies have shown that that the difference between a low income and a high income student, it doesn't start in high school. It doesn't start in middle school. It starts before elementary school. So that has been actually that's been a frustrating part of this entire journey, is just knowing that this is a whole pipeline of issues that just compound on themselves, and we can really only work on maybe one part of it at a time. But every area where you try to fix, there's another problem that's making it worse. Actually, no, the hardest moment is when I've talked to students who do well in school and they want to go to college, but their biggest roadblock is actually their parents. Right? I've spoken to a student who she wanted to go to school. She wanted to go to university and do well and have a successful career. But then when she was looking at universities and trying to figure out how to get in, how to pay for them, she'd have to do it all at school or all at night so that her parents didn't see her because there was resistance.
Why?
I think a lot of it just has to do with unawareness on the parents' part, right? College is a scary experience for someone who doesn't really know what it is. But I haven't encountered direct resistance. Usually it's what I was, and that was just unawareness. I mean, part of our responsibility is to not only help the students, but sometimes help the parents realize the importance of a college education and what it can unlock. I think when the students come in, they're unsure of their own capabilities, right? They know college is hard, definitely. They just don't know if they are up to the task. But I've noticed that, I mean, after they, spend time with their mentors through their program, they learn about college, and then also they see their own skills grow, then they gain confidence in themselves. And really, that's such a huge part of getting students to successfully get into and complete college.
Irene, my name's Irene.
And what do you do here at the Honors College?
A lot. I teach a lot. I help with organizations, but mostly I'm in that fishbowl teaching, 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 right? Generations, it seems. I mean, that's what's interesting too. That's when you know you're doing the right thing too, is when you get emails from somebody 3 or 4 years later who said, "Oh man, I get why there were riots in Chicago and Milwaukee this summer. I get it." So here's what I think. I think that we learn about revolutions and we learn the date and we're supposed to memorize it for history classes. But in fact, revolutions are usually the consequence of hundreds of smaller revolutionary moments that we don't learn about. And so, not knowing that as a child, but knowing that as a historian, sort of looking back on those small revolutionary moments, it makes perfect sense why I teach history the way I do. I don't have students ever memorize dates, on what day did the revolution start? Because that revolution probably started a decade or more ago, right? And so, in my case, because I've had such an odd life, is that we think we're going to have this sort of straight line from childhood to public school to college, graduate school, and boom, all of a sudden you're a professor. And I'm sure some of my colleagues' lives are like that, but mine was not. And so when I look back on how in the world did I become a historian, given that I hated history, it was like my most hated, dreaded subject in school, you really have to look back at those revolutionary moments. And for me, I think that went back to when we first moved from Germany to the United States, and I was about 5 years old. I had three older sisters, and so the six of us were allowed one trunk to squash everything in, and then we rented a tiny, tiny house. I think it was like 550 square feet for the six of us, and they wouldn't accept my father's PhD. So we had to get another one. And so he worked on the lumber docks during the day and he commuted to Austin at night for his PhD. and became a well-known art historian, started the art department here at U of H, brought a lot of sculptures to campus. But I remember like the second week we were here, we moved in October. And my mother insisted it was a hellhole because it's so hot in San Antonio in October compared to Germany. But in any case, so we poor, moved into this little house. My parents started trying to make a home of it. And one day we came home from school and there was a sign in the yard that said, "Nazi, go home." And my sisters and I didn't know what that meant. So we went into the house to tell our parents what was in the yard and what did that mean. And my father sat us down around the little kitchen table and he said, "There's no point in telling you what the Nazis are. The only point is to tell you that there is absolutely no place for hate in this house." Well, at the time, that sort of goes over your head, and you don't really think about it. You're a little sort of fearful because that's a form of bullying, and you weren't quite ready for that. But he said it with such clarity that it clearly sort of sunk in somewhere in my head. And so over the years, I had this tendency to oftentimes get myself in trouble because I was the one who would like take up for someone. It was like I was compelled to do it, but I didn't know why I was compelled to do it. But it turns out my sisters were sort of doing the same sorts of things. You know, and then I, you know, went through public school and did very well and had a voice scholarship and didn't want to sing opera. So then I sang blues and jazz and sang with Willie Nelson for a while. And I mean, I was like all over the roadmap. And then, you know, it all came to a screeching halt with a very abusive husband and a 2-year-old. And so I left and tried to start making a life for myself. And my first thought was school. I should go to school. School is great. Everybody needs a degree. And so I went from a business degree to an accounting degree to a marketing degree to a journalism degree. And as a junior, by then I had enough hours for a junior. And I have this small child and I'm living on food stamps. You know, I'm terrified that I'll never finish. And I take an upper-level course on human rights, and it stopped me in my tracks, just stopped me in my tracks in ways I can't even explain. It's like all of a sudden that little 5-year-old sort of found her place. And so I took another class, and I took another class, and that was my 5th degree change, right? And I knew I had sort of found where I needed to be. But, you know, that's very hard as a single parent, very broke, and looking to finish a degree quickly because, you know, a degree in history or in history with an emphasis on human rights, you know, that's not going to do anything for you at the undergraduate level. So then there was this whole issue about, how do I afford graduate school? But when you find that joy, when it resonates with you the way it does, it's a revolution. And so in some ways, I think it resonated so deeply because I had kept that 5-year-old voice and that experience all those years, right? And I was acting on it in smaller ways by defending people or volunteering a lot. But it never occurred to me that I could actually both do that and teach that. And so when I look then at the sort of history classes I teach, I don't teach her sort of normal history classes. I'm really not at all. You know, I don't teach like the history of Germany or the history of France. I mean, I'm teaching things like fascism and Nazism, and we're covering 6 countries, or, you know, my class on genocide and human rights. We're not really studying how do people commit mass murder. We're really studying human behavior, right? And so when I teach those classes, I still sort of have that little 5-year-old saying, you know, despite the food stamps and the times you were terrified that you'd never finish, you know, and the fact that I stay up sometimes till 4 in the morning because I have so many students, I'm clearly doing what I should have been doing, what I was meant to do. And I would trace that all the way back to that profoundly unsettling moment and empowering moment in the kitchen, you know, with four little girls around the table and my mother and father sort of shocked and scared and surprised that that's how we would be greeted here. And then my father sort of getting right to the heart of the matter. There'll be no hatred in this house. You know, there's that sort of profound moment too when you realize, wow, I got this great, you know, job offer from the federal government. I'll never have to worry again. And then I got a job like at HCC teaching human rights. Oh, let's see, which one shall I do here? And in fact, I went to my, you know, because my husband was so abusive, I had gotten my son into counseling very early. And I remember getting an appointment with her just for me. And she got a big whiteboard out and we made a column of teaching, not teaching. And, you know, at the end of the day, it was so obvious, but I had to sort of convince myself that it's okay to always sort of wonder if you're going to make your next paycheck or that you won't have much savings at the end of the day. That's how much I knew I wanted to teach.